Hello, everyone. Yes, I will use the phrase ChatGPT. That should come as no surprise to anybody. I'm not sure any conversation can go on too long before Gen AI, large language model, or ChatGPT is mentioned. But I want to set some context, particularly since we're at a technology event and we are all technology innovators. This is a quote from William Gibson. I think that technologies are morally neutral until we apply them. It is only when we use them for good or evil that they become good or evil. And realize the we in that sentence is us. We are the people who are making these choices, and it's our responsibility to understand the consequences of those choices. So let's start with the existential question. Will AI destroy the world? There are people who are actually talking about AI as an existential threat to the human race. I think I'm old enough that that won't happen in my lifetime. But I also think that many of these claims are not based in a real understanding of what the technology can do and can't do. But it is true that regardless, we suffer inconsistently from unintended consequences of technology. One of the tricks I like to play is to turn words around. It's like nobody except a hacker would set out to create irresponsible technology. That's not what we're talking about here. And yet we create technology that gets used in ways that we don't expect. It's our responsibility to try to look out for those ways, because the people who are going to be impacted probably don't look like us. They are probably somewhere out there, and we're too focused on solving our problem to see them. And so why are we talking about this now? Well, for one thing, this thing called ChatGPT. If you go back a year ago, yes, people were talking about AI, mostly in the realm of analytics and such. But it wasn't something that many of us interacted with on a daily basis, and certainly not the broader population. It went from something that people just kind of talked about in the abstract to something that people are talking about every day, using it to plan trips and plan weddings, or making mistakes and having to throw themselves on the mercy of the court when, as a lawyer, somebody used it to look up some case to support their brief. And of course, it just hallucinated it and they never checked. So this is one reason why this is so timely. AI is impacting an even broader swath of our lives than it did before. And the way our world is interconnected, the way our information sources are interconnected, makes consequences harder to predict because there are just too many interacting moving parts. I did a roundtable yesterday on this topic, and one person mentioned that the things that worried them the most was AI and AI talking together, that's what really scared them. Because those are interactions that we have to figure out how to intermediate. Because the footprint of AI in our lives is enormous. If it was just Amazon giving you a bad recommendation, that's not life-changing. Being prescribed the wrong drug, or being prescribed the right drug that your doctor didn't think about, but he was able to get some advice from something that told him about a new experimental drug that might have an impact and might actually solve the problem that you're dealing with. These are real-world life and death consequences that we are now facing. And I say on the slide, how do we fix it? But of course, we can't fix it completely. We are humans. We are going to make mistakes. But what we can do is try to mitigate it. And we have this principle of responsible tech. Responsible tech is the active consideration of values, unintended consequences, and negative impacts of technology. Responsible tech includes a wide variety of voices in adoption and deployment and seeks to manage and mitigate potential risk and harm to all communities affected by the technology. And I wish they would have added something positive on the end of this definition, because there's an upside too. As technologists, we think of a target audience. I'm going to solve your problem, and this is how I'm going to solve your problem, and I'm not looking over there at what's happening over there. But if I lift my head up and look around, I might find a new market. I want to briefly go through the results of a report that we did with MIT, asking 500 executives worldwide if they cared about this thing called responsible tech. And what did they see as value? Now, when I first saw the executive summary, I got so excited, because the majority of executives across these companies thought there was value in caring about responsible tech. And then the first thing mentioned was compliance. Shucks. But compliance is an important part of this. What is it that we are trying to legislate? What kinds of constraints do we want to put on industry? They, in fact, said they looked to compliance for guidance about how to make responsible use of technology. But then we started getting into other aspects that really speak to business value. Protect the brand from reputational harm. Enhance the brand because of your commitment to values. Enhancement of your employer brand to make it easy to attract and retain talent. Increased market opportunities because you're thinking about broadening your market, making it more accessible, making your product more applicable. And even increased investor interest. But what kinds of things can go wrong in trying to introduce responsible technology into an organization? One of the most common barriers to adoption is the lack of senior management support and awareness. Now, the good news is, now that AI is scattered across practically every publication that you run across, it is on top of mind for so many people that getting senior management attention is not as hard if you're going to talk about responsible tech in the context of AI. But you still need to get their support, which means they have to have some level of understanding of the technology. And then, of course, we like to talk all about being adaptive and flexible and agile and all of that, but none of us like to change. It's just a fact. We're humans. We don't like change. And, of course, the ever-popular competing priority, which is why I think it's so important to focus on the business value, the business drivers behind caring about responsible tech. While we'd like it to be, it's the right thing to do. It's the responsible thing to do as a corporate citizen of the planet. If you focus on the business value, you can have those more value-based discussions with your leadership. A lack of digital literacy. And this is what really scares me about how prevalent ChatGPT is now, because you have people using these systems that don't understand them well enough and are not cautious enough. I read an article, the crisis management part of a university in the US used ChatGPT to generate an email or a press release in support of another university where there had been a mass shooting. And nobody from the crisis team read it. They just put the press release out directly, and it was completely tone deaf. It broke all kinds of rules that even novices in crisis communication know you don't do in a situation like that. We need people to be literate enough to recognize just how badly these things can go wrong. And now, why is AI particularly problematic in this context? Well, let's think about how AI works and learns. AI discerns patterns from the past. And that means they are going to perpetuate whatever biases exist in the data set. Now, I know people react to that word bias. They get all huffy, and you're telling me I'm a bad person. I want to tell you a story about a source of bias. A research hospital was trying to build an AI model that would recommend whether or not patients should be put into the intensive care unit after a particular procedure. And they trained it in two different ways. One model was very accurate, but it made it very difficult to understand why it was making particular decisions. And the other model wasn't quite as good, but it was very easy to interrogate it. And they realized something. The model made no mention of people with asthma whatsoever. Their protocol had always been to immediately put all asthmatic patients into intensive care. The data set they fed into the learning algorithms had no mention of asthma. And so, of course, it's not like the model at that time was going to make anything up. It wasn't going to hallucinate something. Those researchers were not biased against asthmatics. There was a system that generated a data set that was flawed. And so when we think about AI systems, we need to think about what is the context of the system that generated the data. Now let's think about what ChatGPT or GPT and its mates have been trained on. It's the entire corpus. So you've got science, you've got poetry, you've got Shakespeare, but you also have Machiavelli. You have all the murder mysteries. You have good people and bad people. And remember, this is all unsupervised. That's the system that gave rise to those large language models. It's why you can say, generate me an essay in the voice of William Faulkner, because it has all of William Faulkner in that data set. That has consequences. Another problem, the hallucinations. Someone told me they were working with multiple vendors who said, but their large language model doesn't hallucinate. They'll guarantee it. I'm not sure I know how they do that, but some of the hallucinations are amusing. Some of them are very dangerous. I've already mentioned the lawyer. There are Guardian reporters that have been getting requests for articles that have citations, including what issue they were supposedly issued in, that have never been written. A complete fabrication. These language models don't necessarily know what they don't know. If you ask them something that is clearly outside their scope, they will come back and say, I don't know. But there are limits to that. There's a fascinating paper, fascinating to me at least, out there, LLMs as a stochastic parrot. Because effectively, for those of you who have done any kind of optimization, you can look inside what these algorithms are doing, and they are effectively using a random number generator and some level of control over how far it's going to leap. It's not that different from a process called simulated annealing, for those of you who are familiar with it. And then they're just putting tokens into the stream. That's how they work. We often talk about it doesn't know something. It does feel conversational. It does feel like you're interacting with a human being, but that is not a human being behind that interface. But we've also gotten to an interesting stage where these systems are now doing things that people do not expect. We've also heard that they no longer believe that putting more parameters into the model is going to help them increase the performance of the models. And so I think we're entering a time when we are going to have to start really understanding what is going on in these AI systems. And that's a good thing to me, because we need to have a better understanding of how these things work so that we can better control them. So what kinds of things can we do? We can create methodologies and frameworks and self-regulation. Governments are in fact starting to consider regulations around AI. I know Canada is working on a particular framework. There are discussions in the EU as well. But companies can do this as well. You can decide for yourself, where are we going to use this and where are we not? And what kinds of methodologies do we want to put in place? Like, oh, by the way, if you're in the crisis communication center, read anything that ChatGPT generates before you send it out. Pro tip there. Data protection and privacy. Companies have already gotten burned because somebody put something out onto the public GPT and it got spit back out to somebody else in recognizable form. So we need to think about protection and privacy. There are already many discussions going on using AI to detect PII before it goes into the large language models so that we can at least protect personally identifiable information. And invest in transparency. This is definitely the time to say, yes, I used AI to help me with this. This is where that came from. As well as checking everything that it sends you to make sure, okay, at least those people chasing down the Guardian reporter did the right thing to try to actually get the article. They, in fact, at least figured out that that thing wasn't true. But we need to invest in transparency on how these systems are being used, what data is being accessed, how that data is being used potentially to update the model. And we need to continually audit for biases, both in our data sets as well as algorithmic bias. There are ways to audit for this. There are ways to remediate this, but we have to make that active. And then, of course, let's worry about the carbon, please. the amount of carbon it takes to train one of these LLMs from scratch is enormous. And of course, diversify the workforce so we get broader perspectives and accessible design. This is the thought I want to leave you with. We can make our technology more responsible if we believe we can and insist that we do. And once again, the we in that sentence is us. Thank you very much.